Hey guys, how's it going? Hope you're all doing really well out there today. A while back, we took a look at the containers and services that I run in my home lab, and several people showed interest in a follow-up video where I talk about what hardware I'm using to run my home lab. And the delay in that video is basically a result of my laziness and not wanting to make another video that was outdated the day after I released it. I've been using my HL15 from the folks over at 45 Drives to power the majority of my home lab for a while now, and it's been amazing. It's never failed me, it looks great, and it's got more power than I know what to do with. And that's sort of the problem. With the Xeon Gold processor, 256 gigs of RAM, an RTX 2070, and a couple of hard drives, the HL15 idles at around 120 watts. And when you add that to the three NASs and a bit of networking gear, my Homelab rack idled anywhere between 350 and 400 watts. While I know that that's not a huge amount of power compared to what a lot of people have out there, it seemed overkill and a bit wasteful to just let the rack keep sucking power from the wall, and in turn, my wallet. And instead of doing anything about it, I procrastinated like I tend to do. And then I procrastinated some more. Until recently, I got a letter from my local utility company letting me know that they're going to implement a surge pricing model at the beginning of this month. And that was the kick in the pants that I needed to finally start doing something. But I need to back up just a bit before we move forward. Late last year, the folks from Icewhale, they're the team behind the Zima board, blade, and cube, reached out to me and sent a ZimaCube Pro. And I played with it, but never really did anything with it, as I had my HL15, and the ZimaCube is relatively a niche product with its proprietary configuration. So the ZimaCube just sat in the bottom of my rack, for the most part just collecting dust for about 10 months. So with that little bit of knowledge out of the way, we can kind of go back to where we were when I got the letter from the utility company. Now it's time to do something about optimizing and downsizing my home lab. I already had most of the parts I needed to get the ZimaCube up and running. The Intel A310 Sparkle GPU was just sitting on a shelf, also collecting dust, but I knew that it would not only fit the ZimaCube, but it would be a powerhouse for Plex transcoding. And the ZimaCube already had 32 gigs of RAM in it, so I was basically set there, though I would like to put in 64 gigs when I get a chance. Storage is where things really kind of fell short for me. I had 4 8-terabyte drives, but I really wanted 6 so that I could have all of the drive bays full in the ZimaCube. So I ordered a couple of 8-terabyte drives and got things put together. Now I also had 3 matching 512 gig NVMe drives, so I put those in the NVMe tray in ZimaCube. So bit of a side note here, as much as I would love to show you some fancy B-roll footage of putting things together, most of that process was done late at night and in a bit of a hurry, so I didn't prioritize getting footage, and I'm sort of sorry about that, but I'm glad I got things put together the way I did. So the ZimaCube was ready to fire up, and because I've got such an affinity for Proxmox, that is the OS that I installed on it. I was able to move my VMs and LXCs from the HL15 to my ZimaCube by restoring that morning's backups, and the process went surprisingly fast. I put most of my public-facing apps on the NVMe storage pool, and this is mostly stuff like blogs and wikis and that sort of thing that doesn't have a lot of reads and writes going on while they're running. But it was at this point that I had to decide how I wanted to split things up for my things like my Plex server, my Home Assistant, other more read and write heavy applications. So what I decided to do was set up 2 ZFS pools. One pool is 2 8-terabyte drives, and the other is 4 8-terabyte drives. On the 2-drive ZFS pool, I set up Plex and Home Assistant. But then I did something I hadn't done before that I know a lot of you out there have done, but it was still very new to me. I set up TrueNAS as a VM on the 2-pool drive and passed the other 4 8-terabyte drives through to that VM to let TrueNAS handle them directly. And once I got that configured, I set up a single VDEV in a RAID Z1 for a total of about 21 terabytes of usable space. From there, I set up a few datasets for some of the different shares and copied over all of the media that's been living on my Synology DS1621XS+. Now, I know I could have set up one media share and stored everything that way, but I was learning how to set up datasets, so I just used this as a learning opportunity. The total media that I copied from the Synology over to the TrueNAS VM takes up just a little under 11 terabytes of space, leaving me about 10 terabytes of space left. So I'm actually pretty happy with that. Then I went back to my Plex VM and mapped the VDEVs from my TrueNAS to my Plex server via an FS tab and deployed Plex via Docker with the Intel GPU passed through from the host so I can have it transcode media when necessary. Now, I've never actually really used TrueNAS, so I know that there were a ton of things that I probably could have done better, but again, it was a learning process for me, and I reluctantly kind of enjoyed learning the stuff that I did learn. And the cool thing about having TrueNAS and Plex VMs on the same machine is that all of the data is handled locally via Proxmox and isn't taking up bandwidth on my network, so that's kind of a nice little cherry on top. So with everything moved over to the ZimaCube and working well, I was able to, for the first time in a year or so, shut down the HL15. Now with that big migration complete, or big relatively speaking anyway, it was time to do something about the NAS situation. Now the Synology DS1621 XS Plus is still running 24/7 as it has a few tasks assigned to it. It runs a few Docker containers for different things. My wife and I use Synology Photos to back up our phones, and it takes care of downloading all of my Linux ISOs, and I don't want to reconfigure that somewhere else right now. And my ZimaCube Proxmox setup is attached to it via SMB for VM and LXC backups, so it's probably just gonna stay on indefinitely. But I've also got a TerraMaster F4 424 Max loaded up with drives, and its only job is to be a backup for the ISOs on that 1621 XS Plus. I've also got a Synology DS923 Plus running that acts as a backup for a few things on the DS1621 XS Plus. And I'm currently in the process of ironing out some issues with both the TerraMaster and that DS923 powering on and off at certain times, so that my big Synology can run the appropriate backups that I have scheduled on it. I'm sure it's just something simple that I'll figure out at some point at 3 o'clock in the morning while I'm asleep, but I'm making it work for now. So now that I've just got the network switch, the DS1621 XS Plus, and the ZimaCube running full time, I've managed to get my Homelab power usage down to the neighborhood of like 225 to 250 watts, with a savings in the 125 to 150 watt range overall. And I actually enjoyed most of the process of configuring the hardware and moving things around a little bit to make things more efficient. There were obviously a few hiccups along the way, but overall, I think it was worth it. And if a big project comes up that needs a bit of power to get it working, I can fire up the HL15 and I should have more than enough power to get that job done. If you want more information or want to pick up some of the stuff that I talked about in this video, be sure to check out the video description for links and details. And just as a heads up, the TerraMaster F4 424 is 30% off on Amazon's Prime Day sale going on right now. So I think with all of that said, I'm going to go ahead and wrap this up. I want to thank you guys for spending a few minutes of your day with me here today, and I'll talk to you again here real soon.